Hi, I'm Laurie Brown, and I went to Chicago, Illinois to talk to David Byrne about true stories. He's also written a book about it. And the Talking Heads have a new album that you can hear on the radio and in the movie. They're true stories because he clipped them from papers, tabloids, comic books, whatever you call the National Enquirer and the Weekly World News. True Stories is a documentary, but it's also fiction. It's supposed to take place in a town called Virgil, Texas. No such place. David's also hired real actors, so maybe it's just a regular movie. But there's some real people in it, too. And there's also lots of music. So it's hard to tell where the nutty real stories end and the fiction begins. I asked David if true stories are stranger than fiction.
A lot of times, yeah. A lot of times I had to, in the movie, I had to be careful of the material, in that a lot of material I could have used was so outlandish that no one would have believed it was real, and yet it was. Some of the stuff that got thrown out was true, but it's nobody would have believed it.
True Stories is a deliberate celebration of ordinary, and you've culled a lot of the stuff from the movie from newspapers like The Enquirer and Weekly World News. Most people read those magazines when they're at a lineup at the checkout counter, and they have a good laugh at the people in those magazines with titles like Woman Gives Birth to Twin Red Peppers. As narrator of True Stories, how do you read those articles?
I was attracted to the articles that showed that people as having some kind of inner strength, and that they had, that however nutty they might be, that they'd, that they had some kind of conviction or belief in what they're doing, and that they didn't care that it was unusual or kind of nutty, that they just felt, I am what I am, and that's what I'm gonna do, take it or leave it. And I thought, that really seemed admirable, but it was also funny, too.
Hello.
A lot of the pictures looked prettier on a big screen. Some of the landscapes and the big blue skies and things like that, they really were more striking on a big screen. TV's pretty fascinating, though. I know that even if there's a group of people there and there's a television on, I can't keep my eyes off of it.
You once said that you needed to live in Manhattan. You thought that if you went to the suburbs, you'd get too comfortable and then you wouldn't work. Would someone have to pay you to live in Virgil, Texas?
No, it's a nice place. But it is true.
But you wouldn't want to live there?
Well, it's true that I'm not ready to, I still get a lot of feed off the energy of big cities, some kind of creative energy off that. It doesn't have to be New York, but I think I still find that cities have an energy that I can feed off of. Maybe I'm still not, maybe it's for people who are more sure of themselves than I am, who can say, okay, now I don't need a city and the other people in the city to tell me what I am or to reassure me that I'm doing okay. I can just go live off there. And
I judged a lip sync competition last year, and it really amazes me how popular they are, but mostly, why would someone want to get up, move their mouth, and have someone else's voice come out?
I guess the simple explanation would be that you get to be that star for 3 minutes or whatever. And it's a, it kind of legitimizes whatever you want to do. You can kind of dance around and act kind of ridiculous, and it's kind of cool. In Japan, they do it, they don't do it as lip sync. They do it where they have those karaoke tapes. You go into a bar and you pay the bartender, and they have cassettes that have popular songs without the vocal. And they hand you a microphone and you step over to the corner of the bar, and a lamb hits you, and you sing to all the other drunks. I did it once there, and it was great. All of a sudden, I don't know what they do, but all of a sudden this huge sound comes out, and you sound great. Even the worst singer sounds great, and the music swells, and the lights are on you. It's really something. More.
More.
theme from Mondo.
Talking Heads' live look to stop making sense. There was a big change. I mean, in the early days, you were kind of a minimalist rock band. You had no focused lights. Everything was in the same lights. No long guitar solos. Nothing stood out. Yet all of a sudden, in Stop Making Sense, you've got long guitar solos. You've got great lights, theater, and slides. Why the change?
Part of it was that as our audience grew and we were playing bigger places, it didn't seem just to continue just being a bunch of musicians playing our songs. We kind of thrown out all that stuff in the beginning. We said we'd seen too many bands with too many flashing lights and flashy costumes and gimmicks on stage, and we'd said, okay, we're not going to do any of that. We're just going to turn on the lights and play, and people can take it or leave it. And gradually, as we felt comfortable with other elements, we kind of added them back in, as we could incorporate them in a way that was comfortable for us.
Lots of Talking Heads songs and videos have a lot to do with everyday items, apartment buildings, houses, teapots, vacuum cleaners. Simply by taking these everyday things and putting them into a song, does that make them more interesting?
Yeah, I think so. I think it makes it, to me, funnier, and it makes it appear to be. It's just an appearance. Still a vacuum cleaner, but it makes it seem different if you take a picture of it or sing about it.
Everything with houses, from blowing them up to burning them to watching home movies about them in them. What is this fascination with houses? Has it got something to do with an American fascination of property, or is it simply that that's just where the heart is?
Yeah, I think it has something to do with that, that it probably represents something else. It probably represents being comfortable or being at ease with yourself, something like that. I know houses have symbolized things in psychological terms, but it's also, for me, it's a funny word to say. It sounds funny to say it in a song, and so I kind of get a chuckle out of it.
House?
Yeah.
Someone once described the dancing that you do on stage as a glove on a stick.
Glove on a stick?
Yeah. Where did this interest in dance come from?
I think it came out of just watching people move daily, and motions that people go through in daily life, whether it's frying an egg or walking down the street or typing it or whatever. And then there's kind of movement that people do when they get when they go into trances, when they're possessed or obsessed or whatever. And I kind of like to take all those elements and combine them all together, rather than, and use that as the vocabulary, rather than traditional dance or ballet or anything like that. And I think if you allow things to be seen, then it's like saying to people, we're not trying to trick you. We're not trying to, it's kind of like saying, you can be comfortable with us, we're human, and we're going to show you kind of how the trick's done and where the wires are.
A little known fact of Byrne is that he spent grade 1 and grade 2 in Hamilton, Ontario.
Even at that age, the Canadian school system was ahead of the American one, so that I could kind of coast through the school in the States, because I'd already been through almost all that in the Canadian school.
In 2 years?
Yeah, in 2 years. I was already almost a year ahead.
Wow. I'll be glad to hear this back home. So you owe it all to the Canadian school system?
Yeah. Got a little early head start.
Next on The New Music, David Byrne talks about TV, parking, and bursting into song.
Excuse me, Mr. Culver. I forgot what these peppers represent.
David has always been interested in how things fit together, from cities to countries, from factories to suburbs. And even though True Stories is about a small town, there's some pretty big topics. He talks about the changing economic structures in cities, And he also spends quite a bit of time on the architecture of the future. And also on the importance of shopping malls. How does he get all this in one movie and still make it interesting? But it's not just about the big things, it's about things like driving. Is there anything more important to Americans than ample parking?
No, it's real. Yeah, it's real important. You can even look out.
Well, how much ample parking?
Not
is
from
there?
Where we are,
no.
But from even this hotel, that is probably the. I gotta put these back on.
Sure.
In this hotel, the parking structure is almost as big as the hotel. It's just massive. It's odd to think of these huge buildings and they're not for anything but parking cars in.
You say that people at the ends of empires get into some pretty weird things. What does True Stories tell us about America as it nears the end of its empire?
To me, it's saying that there's still a lot of creativity out there. And I guess what I'm saying in the movie is that it's out there. It's not in museums or places like that. That ordinary people are doing really innovative, creative things and having a lot of fun and doing kind of nutty stuff that's wonderful. But at the same time, I think probably like the economic center of the world is moving towards Japan, and that the whole period of the United States as the world power or whatever is it's reached its peak, and now I think it's settling into something that I hope is a little more reasonable.
One thing about ends of centuries and ends of millenniums that tend to be extra creative times.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that's true?
Yeah, I think it's probably a period where like they're shucking off all the old baggage and all the old things that they grew up with, and that they have this, they see this big possibility of what could happen in the future, and that they're looking forward to that. So they feel like they can do anything, that anything's open to them. Either that or they feel like the whole world, there's going to be the end of the world. A lot of people feel that at the end of the century means the end of the world. I kind of hope not.
In movie musicals of the 1950s, people were bursting into song everywhere, in restaurants, in fields, in supermarkets. Well, people don't seem to buy that, so it's a lot tougher to get music into movies nowadays than it was in Rodgers and Hammerstein's time. If we do get music in film now, it's because there's usually a concert built right into the story. So I asked David if modern-day audiences can suspend their disbelief like the musical audiences of the 1950s.
I think maybe they could if it was done in a particular way, but it'd be much more difficult than it used to be, I think.
Why do you think that is?
I don't know.
If you had to choose one medium to tie up all these cultural loose ends we've been talking about, like dance and theater and fashion and food styling, which one would it be?
Well, in movies, you can kind of throw everything in. You kind of throw in all that acting and movement and sound and characters and everything. But at the same time, a stage performance is real, real different than that. In a stage performance, there's a certain kind of intimacy and excitement, and a kind of and you can have different things going on at the same time on stage. You can have one person on one side doing this, and another person doing this, and somebody else singing in the middle, and this kind of comes off of all that going on at once. And it's hard to do that in a movie. In a movie, you have to cut from one thing to another to show what's going on. And that kind of takes away from some of that.
One other thing, I have something in my bag I wanted to show you. I have also been collecting clippings for a very long time. And this one came from the National Enquirer. And this is from about 1977. And I wonder if you could read this and give me your impression, see if it's still true.
86% of Americans prefer real-life experiences to watching them on TV. An overwhelming majority of Americans, 86%, say they want to experience life directly rather than observe it through television. This is like something out of the 50s.
Yeah, well.
It's nice to hear that people would rather live life than watch it on TV.
In his book, David Byrne says the real wealth of the country is in its people. You may have heard other musicians like Bruce Springsteen say that. But thankfully, David also says that the new patriotism is a trick. But because his movie celebrates Middle America, Dave's made some strange new fans. For instance, Time magazine loved the movie. They called it the divine comedy of the 80s and compared David to the great Italian poet Dante. Wow. So as far as Middle America, Dave is okay. The Toronto Globe and Mail called it a smug movie. They say that David's liberally gifted, but a patronizingly sentimental aesthete. For me, the best thing about the picture was its style. It's a cross between a Diane Arbus photograph and a Blondie comic strip. It's simple, and it's easy to imitate. And it's also an awful lot like Talking Heads' music. The only difference is that David put it into a movie. Finding out what's about everyday things makes for good songs, and I think it's made a good movie.
Still to come on the new music, Papa John Phillips and gonzo journalist Hunter S. Thompson.
It's the
music with hosts Laurie Brown and Denise Don.